Hello there, it's Colin Anderson speaking. I'll just share my content there.
Yes, we have it.
So I'll just start there. It's a pleasure to be with you here today. I'm Colin Anderson from kind of the Midlands of Ireland, and I work with Lakeland Dairies as part of the Lakeland Dairies Chagas Joint Programme. A little bit about myself. I've come from a mixed farm, dairy, beef and sheep, and I never really expected to do much work in industry, but I do plan to go home farming in time to come, but it's been a great experience working with Lakeland so far. So what is the Lakeland Dairies Chagas Joint Programme? First of all, Lakeland Dairies is one of the largest milk processors in Ireland. It has 3,200 suppliers with a milk pool of 1.85 billion litres. It's expanded rapidly since humble beginnings nearly 100 years ago and mergers with different cooperatives. It's now one of the largest dairy players on the island of Ireland. It has 8 processing plants across half of the country, covers 50% of the land base in Ireland, and collecting from 3,200 farmers. Chagas is the state authority, agricultural authority in Ireland. Its role is the research and development of all new agri-based trials and investigations in agriculture. And once them trials and research is done, it's kind of secondary job is the training and advisory and knowledge transfer to farmers. Did operate in the whole of the Republic of Ireland with dairy specialists, beef specialists and tillage and sheep specialists in each county. The program itself in the Lakeland Dairies Chagas Joint Programme, it has 3 staff members, 2 Lakeland employees, of which I am one, and then there's 1 Chagas employee. And between us, we are kind of covering the 2,000 suppliers in the Republic of Ireland in a number of different ways. Obviously, we're not able to do farm visits with all of them. We do our on-farm consultations with a number of farmers, and then between different medias and been written and internet means, we contact the full supplier base. The program was set up in 2013 and it's in its 3rd 3-year cycle. So each cycle, there's a different objectives and different objectives and goals and research we want to get out to our suppliers. The program itself is funded by Lakeland Dairies. So the staff and the staff is funded by Lakeland Dairies and paid for by Lakeland. Any of our expenses, whether it be getting out to farmers, any way that we use, get knowledge transfer across, is all funded by Lakeland Dairies. Chagas helps in the form of training and guidance. So the 3 staff members is all trained by Chagas. We have a kind of consultant that if we have any difficult questions or any things that may happen on farms, there's a consultant with Chagas that helps guide and move the program forward. So as I was saying, it was set up in 2013. That was in advance of the quota removal in 2015. And in Ireland at that time in the dairy industry, there was a lot unknown about what was going to happen. Different studies said there was an expected 40% increase in milk production in the Lakeland Dairies region. And It was a fast changing industry. There was a lot of farmers expanding. There was a number of mixed farmers focusing solely on dairy production. So there was a lot of unknown, there was a lot of risks. A lot of people was fearful post quota, more milk price volatility. So it was a rapidly changing dairy industry. So that would be the main focus why that the program was set up. The first kind of objectives in the first 3 year cycle was the planning for sustainable expansion. So that was risk management. So borrowings, your stocking rates, understanding your feed costs, labor costs, and can this be, is this achievable? What some farmers were planning with doubling cow numbers. Obviously they weren't going to double profits. I heard of 100 cows going to 200 cows. The 100 cow isn't going to, the 200 cow isn't going to make as much as the 100 cow. So there was a lot of intricate details there that had to be discussed and planned out with farmers. Infrastructure planning. So slurry storage, milking facilities, cow accommodation. They're all the bricks and mortar things in the yard that cost a lot of money, but they don't really make the money. It's about the quality of cow, your grazing infrastructure, the amount of reseeding, and how fertile your soils was. So that was often an area under or overlooked. And we brought the attention to farmers that it's not just in the yard you need to be planning, it's also in the field. And then there was a number of financial and cash flow workshops and on-farm consultations. Every farm's financial and cash flow circumstances are different. So they were often done just estimating costings, repayment capacity, all things that was discussed in the first kind of 3 years of the program. The program objectives is to help all Lakeland Dairy suppliers with education and advice on a number of topics. Technical performance, whether that be with grass production or utilization. You know, there's a big open goal here on a lot of farms that, you know, simple soil fertility corrections will grow a lot more grass, reduce purchase feed overall, increase margin per litre. So it is a big open goal there for farmers and a topic that the co-op wanted to, co-op and Chagas wanted to get across to farmers in another means. Milk solids production, that's what it's all about. We're not predominantly a liquid-based production system or country. It's a manufacturing country, so the concentration of our milk is very important. So there's a lot of education there, whether it be on feed quality, your grass, and genetics. So aiming, breeding the best genetics for your herd to help increase your fat and protein concentration in the milk. Calving interval was a big thing at the start of the program. You know, the fertility wasn't really in a lot of the herds. Calving interval at the minute would be around the 380 days. We'd like to get that down, but previously there's still a lot of herds over 400 days. So help improving on-farm management with breeding decisions, body condition scoring, assessing cows, tail pain to see what cows aren't coming back in heat, and the big open goal again of the genetic fertility was one we wanted to get across. And the cost of a poor calving interval was a big factor. And also the fat and protein percentage were pegged on the concentration of our milk. So obviously the higher the fat percentage, the higher the protein percentage, the higher price the farmer's going to get for their milk. So that was another big objective for the program. Point number two there, selecting the best genetics for your herd. There's a breeding index called EBI. EBI stands for Economic Breeding Index. And Lakeland Dairies herds was one amongst the lowest co-ops EBI in the country. And that was something that wanted to be addressed in the programme. And with all these topics, they're all an ongoing objective. There's no specific target to reach, but each target is upwards and an improvement. So there's a number of workshops done on EBI, breeding and fertility workshops, to help educate. There's still a little bit of concern with EBI that it's not for some herds. It's more suited to spring calving herds and not winter calving herds. But we've done a lot of workshops on that. And the message is slowly getting across to farmers that EBI is working. It's working in their herds. And it's improving their net profit at the end of the year. Animal health, somatic cell count, so SCC is somatic cell count, and milk recording is another program initiative. It's a big thing, and it's a big open goal again on a lot of farms. Animal health, it's big. Get your cow calving correctly. She reaches peak yield. She's healthier. She makes you more money. And there's a lot of education about that, the costs of ill health, quality condition score, and animal health planners. And somatic cell count and milk recording was an area we wanted to get down, and farmers are really going towards that milk recording. Their milk recording, they're getting back the results. They can treat the cows with some infection. And they can help make the best breeding decisions based on their milk recordings. So they can. Another area was expansion planning with new entrants and existing suppliers. So like new entrants into dairy and since the abolition of quota is it's forming a major part of our supplier base. I'd say in between 15-20% of the milk process this year will be coming from new entrants that have started in the last 5 years. So new entrants have really pushed on the capacity of Lakelands and its future. So it has. So new entrants is something that we'd work with, and we'd be trying to encourage them to Lakeland Dairies co-op rather than competitor co-ops. An expansion plan, as I've touched on earlier, there's a lot of herds expanded over the last number of years. When the program started, herd size was 60 cows. Into 2020, it's about 85 cows, average herd size. A lot of family-run farms increasing by a couple of cows, 20 cows or so, and some herds doubling up. So there was a lot of expansion planning with suppliers. And another area that we focus on is labour efficiency. Maybe not the funnest topic to talk about with farmers. They're getting all the work done. But when you combine increase in herd size, you have to get efficient with your time and with your labour and your staff and your technologies on your farm. So between those, there was a 28-page booklet designed and wrote up and posted out to every supplier on labour efficiency with a number of techniques and areas to look at and address in your farm, and it was received very well. It's not necessarily about getting a bigger bucket, labour efficiency. It's, you know, looking at your units, have you enough units, calf shed management, milk transport, a number of groups of stock. There's a number of areas to be looked at and addressed with labour efficiency. And it's often an area that can go overlooked when things is just getting done. But if there's an injury or farm succession, poor labour efficiency can often hinder farm succession. So it's to make dairy farming more appealing to the next generation. So labour efficiency was a big focus area. Who do we work with? So we work with all Lakeland Dairy suppliers, potential new entrants to dairy farming, as I said earlier, they're forming a big part of our customer base or our supplier base. And like, there's going to be, I'd say, about 60 new suppliers in 2021 entering into milk. And there really is no recession when it comes to milk parlors, cubicles, and to do with a dairy cow. It's all go in Ireland. And suppliers seem confident, new entrants seem confident, and we'd be confident ourselves in Lakeland that price seems to be steady. There was a lot said after quota that it'll be up and down, a lot more up and down milk price, but it's been steady. The print price really hasn't changed more by up or down by 3-4 cents. So it's been steady, and farmers are confident that that trend will continue. It will have its up and downs, but on a year rolling year average, the milk price hasn't varied too much. More time is obviously allocated to farmers that ask for more assistance. So if we, and sustained assistance is offered once messages are taken and acted upon. If a farmer asks for a on-farm consultation, we'll do our best to call out. We'll do kind of a farm appraisal. We'll make suggestions on farm improvements to help their profits and their margins and their technical performance. And if we find that farmers are engaging and taking messages on board, we'll definitely be there to do more on-farm consultations, answer any questions they have, whether it be on farm or over the phone. Now, there obviously is the supplier base that they're tipping away the best, they're happy out, they're not taking the messages on board, but we prioritise our time towards the suppliers that wants to improve their farm profits or expand them, and them suppliers are the most likely to engage with the programme. I must mention that the service is free to all suppliers, and it's free to all suppliers, which is a big incentive to get in the gate with a farmer you want to work with. And the incentive is that if we can improve technical performance, get a new entrance into the co-op, that their milk will make a margin, and the investment of our time and our time and resources into a supplier will increase their performance, increase their yields that's supplied to Lakeland, and then that's when the program is paying for itself. Other positive outcomes from the program. So most of our work is to help farms with technical efficiency and financially. That's the whole objective of the program was set up, technical efficiency, farm viability, and improving that. But indirectly, it has many positive effects. Better grassland management equals less purchase feed required, because if you're managing the grass better, you're better quality grass, you can get away with feeding less meal or concentrates with a better margin. So that's the message to the farmer. But indirectly, that less purchase feed has a better carbon footprint for our milk. So farmers might be, it's not, they don't feel like there's a financial reward to being more carbon friendly into the future, but does doing the thing better is financially rewarding in itself. And another topic is more labor efficient farms equals more farm succession. So it's a big thing there. The age demographic of our suppliers, it's 50 to 60, the average age. The number of suppliers under the age of 35, 2-3%. Now, farm partnerships has helped that dramatically. So that the father and the son, or the father and the daughter, can both have management decisions on the farm. It is. This is an example of some of the work I do. I'd be on this planner once or twice a week with different suppliers. It's a new entrant business planner, and just an example of two of the pages that the farmer would receive back. So if we had a new entrant planning to get into milk, or a farm thinking of expanding or changing his enterprise in a way, whether it be buying land or renting land, we can put this into our planner, and it manages the stocking rates, the livestock units on the farm. We put in our example yields, fat and proteins, and then it computes the financial return back to the farmer. So you'll see on the right hand side we have our high, medium and low. And your high, medium and low refers to how efficient the farmer is. So the key factors we look at here is your milk from forage. So that's the amount of milk that you get from grass and silage, because the majority of the farmers here in Ireland is a grass-based system. They're grazing for anywhere from 200 to 280 days a year, with as short of winter period as the weather and the ground conditions allow. So that's the milk from forage piece. So obviously, the more milk you get from forage, the lower cost of production you have, because forage is your cheapest feeds. Your grass could cost you anywhere from 7 to 8 cents a kilo, your silage 15 cents a kilo, and your concentrates anywhere from 25 to 30 cents a kilo. So a big focus on milk from forage, and there's a big profit indicator on all farms. Annual grass production is obviously a big factor too, and it's a big factor we try and get across to farmers. If you're not growing enough grass, if you're not growing for your stocking rate, you're going to have to buy in purchase feed in the form of concentrates, silage, maize silage, brewer's grain, all that costs more than the homegrown forage. Homegrown forage is the cheapest feed. So simple grass production, so reseeding, liming, PK, it's all messages we try to get across to farmers. And the hidden cost that's a very expensive cost is our replacement rate. So the higher your replacement rate, so replacement rate is the amount of cows you need each year to replace the cows leaving the herd. So the lower the better. If you have to replace 10 cows, it's a lot cheaper than replacing 20 cows. So that's your management and the genetic fertility playing a factor in that. So that's an example of a plan we'd be bringing back to a farmer, showing them you might want to see if I increase my fat percentage and protein percentage by 0.1 each, what effect will it have on my farm? If I grow more grass, what effect will it have on my farm? I mean, that's the bottom line figures at the end of each year. So it's a very useful tool in getting some messages across. That simple changes on your farm can lead to big financial benefits.
Time is running
our
out.
Knowledge transfer methods. So the way we get our information across the farmers, realistically in 2020 with COVID, it has changed a lot. It's moved a lot more online, on phone. Any messages we can deliver via email, phone or online is done that way now. What we often done in previous times in on-farm walks, and it's something we'd love to get back to. You see the picture on the left. It's a new entrant event. We brought farmers to a new entrant down in County Westmeath that was thinking of getting into milk, and just showed them what we were explaining to them. Good cows, good grass, and good people gets good returns. Picture on the right was a somatic cell count and somatic cell count and milk recording event, showing people the benefits of that. Another few pictures of events we do. So they're all very practical. They're all in a comfortable setting for farmers to attend. The one on the left was a winter milk event, showing them the correct calving pattern and breeding plan for a successful winter milk herd. And the picture on the right was a roundtable discussion. Back in 2018, late 18, there was a drought in various parts of our catchment. And we were thus helping farmers with, if they had a short forage supply, methods to overcome it.
Mr. Anderson, we have to finish there. I'm sorry.
I think this is the last slide. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, our knowledge transfer methods, discussion groups. We might gather 10, 15 farmers together and on a farm in the field, chat about grass, cows. It's a comfortable setting. Technical workshops like that roundtable discussion is another great way to get information across if there's a little bit more detail required. On-farm consultations, and that would be my most preferred one. You can get in real deep into farmers. Farm walks is another one, and a number of kind of online methods, so newsletter articles, videos, and publications, like the one on the left, is all simple methods to get information across. So that's the whole presentation there, folks, and thank you for your time. Mm-hmm. If there are any questions, I can certainly take them.
Well, this, thank you. So I'll ask in Latvian, and you will get a translation if you're ready. There's one question. What is the percentage or normal percentage of failure you have your... Oh, Latvijski. Tātad, kas ir normāls izgāšanās procents, ja tā var teikt, konsultācijās? Jums ir savs biznesa plāns sagatavots katram konkrētajam piegādātājam?
And it is normal that so and so many percent from that cooperation doesn't succeed, and so you do not reach some goal. So is there such a figure, such failure?
Yes. Well, with our new entrants entering the co-op and planning to start into milk, I'd say anywhere from 10 to 20%. Once you do them on paper and show them a plan, it's not feasible. I think there was only one supplier out of the last 200 that went into milk for 2 years and it didn't work. And it was probably more demand than the plan that was the problem.
All right. Thank you. Paldies.